Hello, I'm Rick Love for Sun TV and the Sonoma International Film Festival Filmmaker Artist Interview Series, and we have with us directors Dave Wruck and Robin Bond and cast member and real-life roller derby girl Suzie Hotrod, and the film is Derby Baby, a very exciting film that is screening as part of the festival. So this is, for people who don't know, flat track women's roller derby, which is, you know, we may remember the bank track, but the thing about flat track, and I think what comes across so clearly in your film, is how this is a do-it-yourself sport. This is a sport that kind of started really with an aesthetic, and then the sport came out of that. And it's very exciting for that reason.
It really is, and I think that what you were talking about, the flat track component is what has made this sport so accessible to women all around the world.
Mm-hmm. It's really like, you've heard plant a seed and a tree will grow. This thing too, this sport, add water, and it's just going to pop up somewhere real quick, instantaneously.
Mm-hmm. How did you get started in the sport, Suzie?
I began playing roller derby in 2004, which in terms of derby career life makes me one of the longest skaters in the sport. And because of the flat track, do-it-yourself aspect, that's the only reason we were able even to start. And we literally did use chalk and draw out. We played on asphalt under the West Side Highway on basketball courts at roller rinks, like outdoor hockey rinks in Chinatown, before we ever found a place to even play in a rink or an indoor venue of any sort. So we just got together, kind of guessing what the game even was. We'd only heard about it from someone that had taken a trip to Texas and seen it happening in Texas, and then they decided they had to start it in New York. So I got in there at the very, very beginning, and now my team, the Gotham Girls in New York, has won the national championship twice. So we've come a long way from chalk on the asphalt, but we did it too, and everybody who's at the chalk on the asphalt stage right now all over the world can know that only in a few short years you could be the national champions.
Well, and one of the things that strikes me about your story and the story of the of your club is how it really built from the ground up. I mean, there weren't national championships for years until it came in, and it this kind of this grassroots from agreeing on the rules to agreeing on who plays who to getting, it just seems like it's this very amazing amount of consensus built among the different clubs in order allowing you to compete and to get bigger and bigger and bigger. That's fascinating.
It is, and I think it's very large kind of decision by committee the way it's run, and it's working.
One of our interview subjects said there's epic amounts of listening in roller derby.
Mm-hmm. Well, and it's certainly tough to imagine, you know, having just played pickup basketball with guys, it's very tough to imagine, you know, who can't agree on a foul, being able to take it to this national and international level that women's flat track roller derby has gotten to.
Yeah, that's one of the points that was made in our movie, is that it's a relatively young sport, you know, like Suzie was saying, and if you look at any sport, it goes through many, many incarnations and rules changes before it becomes really what it is. And roller derby's been on the fast track with all that.
And how rough is it out there? Because you're a jammer, so you're the person that is, it's your job to lap the other team and to score the points. So how rough is that when you're out there?
Right. Yeah, well, and for those that haven't seen roller derby, that's a really good summary of what the jammer is. The jammer is the one that has the star on their helmet. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they get the points for passing, which means everyone would like to stop you, which is usually involving being blocked to the ground.
Right, which is no elbows. It has to be shoulders, hips, and booty.
Absolutely, yeah. You can't, there's no slide tackle, there's no high elbows,
Stiff arm. No
clotheslining. Mm-hmm. And you could do a lot of damage with the legal target zones, but it's definitely really serious and physical, and it hurts. And, you know, our practices are the same level of intensity as our games, and we just beat each other for hours on end, just like anybody at a hockey practice would, you know. We're really serious about it, and injuries are really common, and it's totally accepted, and we don't, you know, lie to ourselves. We understand the risk of what we do, but we also try to, you know, be good athletes and build our muscles and you know, do cross training so that we can prevent injury and be as well-rounded and ready for the high-intensity world that we play in. And it's really serious as far as, like, athleticism and aggressiveness how badly you can get banged up out there.
Well, and certainly you look at what hockey players wear, and you're wearing 10% of what you've got, elbow pads on and some knee pads. I mean, it's you're exposed when you're skating on the flat track.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think even I've had some pretty serious shoulder damage done from hitting people with my shoulders. We don't wear shoulder pads. I know like a lot of skaters are starting to wear optional shin guards. Mm-hmm. And they talked about it in the movie too. People, you'll see, talk about the added sometimes protective gear. But you know, you get kicked in the shin with a roller skate, or you fall on a roller skate, you're like out for 3 days hobbling, you know, with a big bruise.
Well, in the skates themselves, that was a question I had. You're doing kind of what I would call the old school four wheels on the floor roller skates. Was there ever a thought about roller blades, which was a much bigger pastime when roller derby, flat track roller derby came in? Was it always going to be the four skates on the floor? Any thoughts about rollerblades in the beginning?
As far as we know, everyone is always, it's this unspoken law, basically. They call them quads, and it's quads only. And, you know, even if you show up at a practice, I saw a couple of refs show up at practice once with rollerblades on, and they were pretty much chastised for the rest of the night. That I don't think it's in, is it in the rule book? Is it in WFTA rules? It's in WFTD rules?
Certainly it must formally be written somewhere.
Yeah, it must be.
In order to be a skater, you must be on quad skates. There are referees, I think, that will delve into the rollerblade, but it's certainly not really too politely accepted in the culture. Although we have lots of friends of the family that are, anybody that's skating is a friend of the family. You know, we're not nasty, you know?
The quote from your film that I like the most, and I think it sums up your sport the most, was, unlike other sports where you started with a sport and a culture formed around it, your sport started with a culture. And the thing that's interesting in your film, the tension that starts to come in from your film, is your sport's at a crossroads, because you see this Charlotte Club, and the Charlotte Club is coming at it from a very different perspective. There's a money man involved, and the skaters aren't paid yet, but they don't have to do all of the other do-it-yourself, the marketing and the preparation. And the look of those skaters is very different. They look more like a soccer team. Mm-hmm. And to me, that's where the tension's coming in, because all of a sudden I'm getting this feeling like there was an aesthetic that clearly, from Resurrection Roller Girls in Runner Park, our local club, there was a very clear aesthetic that started. And I'm wondering, I mean, I was feeling kind of threatened by that, and I'm wondering if you can feel comfortable talking about that crossroads that you're at right now.
Yeah, I think we could talk about it, and it'll be interesting. We're all kind of waiting with bated breath to see where that goes, you know, if this kind of for-profit model, you know, which is frowned upon, I guess, by many of the leagues, versus the sort of DIY. I think Charlotte really was interested in creating truly a family event. And I know not everybody kind of agree. I mean, I bring my family to all the events, mm-hmm. you know, but they wanted to kind of turn it into something that any media would latch onto and not be concerned about the racy skate names, that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. So there's been some conflict about it, for sure.
It that comes through. And because it's, as a you know, lifelong fan of punk rock, from everything to the alternative culture, it didn't sit right. With me, just as a viewer, and this is just me personally, I'm not speaking for anyone else, about this idea of, and it's not like it's Nike or somebody like that, it's a very different approach, and I'm wondering if you, as a skater, how you kind of feel about this different approach to this sport that you love so much.
Sure. Well, I will say, I actually didn't know about this league until I had seen the movie, being from Gotham Girls, the number one team in the WFTDA, which is the Women's Flat Track Derby Association, kind of setting the bar for the entire sport, skill-wise, all over the country. And we are doing really successfully in New York. We're a non-profit. That doesn't mean we can't retain profit from our bouts and things like that. Mm-hmm. It just has to do with our business model, in the sense that we're about promoting women's athleticism into the community and things like that. So our business model is not unlike one that would like to be making profits. But thus far, it hasn't necessarily reached that point yet. But we think that also our model can be extremely successful. And as far as people wanting to be invested in us, as far as sponsors and people that want to be involved in our name, we're definitely capable of and interested in bringing in people to support us. Our structure is already quite functional in that business model, so I think both can actually be functioning and working. We're not owned by a corporation. We have, you know, our setup is the nonprofit, which I think many of the major leagues in the WFTDA are actually in that business model. And it seems like either one could really work as long as somebody wants to get involved and maybe support more financially. Or just, you know, there's the, in the movie, there's the Denver team that has been involved in a contract with an entertainment company, which you guys can probably speak to, mm-hmm. which has also brought them a sort of slightly different business model. That's another way of bringing in more audience. All of us, I think, we just want audience, mm-hmm. more right. people coming in, and then what happens next. So I'd be curious to see what the numbers as far as attendance goes for any different game. The fans don't know the difference
certainly
about the structures. They just mm-hmm. want to see roller derby, really. They could probably speak more to the Denver structure.
Well, and I think these are all good problems to have. There, because you've got a broad base of support. The movie focuses a lot on getting a lot of the younger people in, and it's all good problems to have, because your sport is growing, and there's a lot of support for it. So I guess these are growing pains, and it's a good thing. The film is Derby Baby. Directors Dave Wruck and Robin Bond, and Suzie Hotrod, who appears in the film. It is screening at the Sebastiani Theater at 3 p.m. today, and in attendance will be Sonoma's own Resurrection Roller Girls, as well as Sacramento's Sacred City Derby Girls. Thanks very much for coming and talking to us today.
Thank you, Rick.
Thanks.